Hey there, this is Tony Oliver, and you're listening to Three Black Geeks.
We talked about those four movies. We talked about those four things in the franchise, and it was wonderful. Last year, we did the Terminator. Yes, that classic. Well, two classics. But yes, we did the Terminator, and it was lovely. This year, the boys decided to do something special, something grand. And this year is the Karate Kid. The Karate Kid, about a young boy from New Jersey who comes.
look, here's the funny thing. When you say the plot out loud, you cannot help but laugh because it really doesn't make a lot of sense.
It's a kid from New Jersey who took karate lessons at the local Y.
Hold up, not the local Y. He ran into the first Japanese person he ever met in his life, and just so happened, Japanese person knew how to do karate.
I gotta be real with you guys. It wasn't just some Japanese dude. It really wasn't. Pat Morita.
Jesus, Pat Morita.
Pat freaking Morita.
Here's the funny thing about Pat Morita where a lot of people actually don't know. Pat Morita was actually in Red Fox's Circle. I wish I could bullshit you.
Sanford and Son as Achu.
He was not just that. He was one of the comedians that actually traveled with Red Fox. And Red Fox hooked him up when he was out there in Las Vegas. So in other words, that means one thing. Most definitely, Pat Morita sniffed coke off a white bitch's breast. That happened.
And he lived a hell of a life for it, too.
Clearly, he sniffed coke because apparently NBC pitched him the Karate Kid TV cartoon, and he's like, fuck it, why not?
No, Pat Morita ain't stupid. You know, look, he's a brown person like us. I don't know how long these white people are going to be enthralled with my ass, so I'm going to say yes to this shit.
Hey, Pat, we're going to do a Karate Kid TV show. We're going to introduce actual magic. How about that? Fuck it. Why not? Go for it.
You know what? It's amazing that Pat Morita only did these white belt level punches, and yet white people magic. That shows you.
Listen, now, he was on American Ninja level. In fact, he was in two American Ninja movies.
This is the thing. The only reason why they got him was because they saw Morita. Morita. Wait a minute. Like, Morita, is that Korean? Japanese. Whatever. You in the movie.
We're gonna put you in Bloodsport 2 as the old Asian wise man, as the master. It's either between you or Mako. Y'all rock, paper, scissors that shit.
Oh, my God. You know him and Mako, they didn't like each other. You know they did it.
They rock, every paper, scissors at every audition. They looked at each other like, Mako, Morita.
He was like, Mako-san. Pat Morita. Yeah, Pat. What are you trying to say? Yeah, and I don't know what you think I'm trying to say. You're making fun of my name is Pat? Yeah. American Japanese boy, they just get in a fight with it.
I got a feeling that they fought over that Disney money for Mulan or who's gonna voice the emperor, and Pat Morita won out.
It's like no, you know, no, actually Mako didn't give a crap. Mako was doing Aku at the time. He was probably like, wait a minute, you
did
that?
This is 98. This is 98. It didn't happen yet.
Not yet. You're right. Not yet. You know what Mako probably did say? He like this. So why you do that? Because it was good money. You do realize you're adding to the stereotype, right? What stereotype? That all Asian people are the same. Hey, yo, Mako, kiss my ass. I want a check.
I wipe my ass with Disney bucks.
I was like, what are you going to do, huh? What are you going to do? Like, I was in Highlander 3. Like, you make fun of me now, but children are going to remember me forever. Doing what? Some stupid cartoon character? 3 years later.
Oh, man. The Karate Kid was one of those movies that, look, let me tell you something. It was the 80s, and apparently all you needed to be a bad guy was just be a douche.
You know what? You know what the best thing about him is? He realized that his career only going to be limited to just doing that type of a role, because that's all he did from here on out.
The whole plot of The Karate Kid centers around Ralph Macchio as Daniel LaRusso and his mom, who, as the series progresses, she just kind of fades out the picture, especially when it hits the second movie where it's like, okay, she's there. And then the third movie, is he living with his mom anymore? How old is Daniel? I don't know.
What's going to make this this year's franchise look into this franchise so interesting is that, unfortunately, no, we won't be doing what I call the Black Karate Kid. We won't be doing the newest one. The main reason why is just because it kind of didn't fit scheduling. Not a big deal, but don't worry, because I know CJ. He jerks that movie off. Not because of Jaden Smith. Not because of Jackie Chan, but Taraji P. Henson's in it, and, you know, DMV for life, y'all. You know, we always got...
Yeah, and also, she was playing a sassy black mama, like she always plays in every movie.
Hey, real talk. If I can say anything about that, when I think back on that movie, there was a lot of bullshit in that movie, too.
Hey, look, man, look, compared to this movie and stuff, those kids in that new Karate Kid movie were blood fucking thirsty to kick the shit out of Jaden. It's like, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, we weren't ready. You know the scene I wish happened? Jackie Chan beating the living crap out of those kids like Pat Morita did in this movie.
Listen, okay.
I was waiting for all those kids to jump. Kids to jump Jaden out of nowhere, and all of a sudden you just see Jackie Chan show up like, get him! And Jackie Chan runs away, and they do the stupid thing. They corner Jackie, and there's a chair right beside him.
Listen, let me tell you something about this movie, okay? When Daniel is getting, like, bullied by the bad guys, Pat Morita literally comes out of nowhere like the wise Asian person and just judos the fuck out of these people to death.
And see, that's the funny thing about the whole series. The whole series makes Pat Morita or Mr. Miyagi, they make Mr. Miyagi this... We used to make a joke about this, where where we say mystic Asian magic.
Yeah.
Because for some reason in the 80s and probably into the early 90s, Asian people were treated like they were magical. If black people created rap music and we were like stock thugs, Asian people were like either stock thugs or like freaking ninjutsu artists for no fucking reason. They will always do that to their characters, man. And in this one, Mr. Miyagi is like this simple, like I said, he's a simple, like this simple man that lives by himself and just so happens he knows the art of karate and knows it very well enough to teach some kid to how to win.
Now, Ralph Macchio, right? That dude was 22. He did not look 22 in this movie.
And that makes perfect sense because he acted like he was not, because the way he acted in this movie, he didn't sound like a teenager at all, man. And I was saying to myself, well, D, those were kid actors back in the 80s, man. Wait, this nigga was 20 what?
Yeah, especially when the year before he was in The Outsiders and he looked young as shit in that movie.
Man, see, that's what happened. See, that's what happened, man. What we didn't realize is that KFC has had all this, it's the hormones in the chicken now to make everybody look older. So we didn't have that problem back in the 80s, man.
So Daniel and his mom, they moved from Jersey to Reseda, California, which is around the Los Angeles area, basically.
And every time Daniel talks, it's like he's about to go on to a Andrew Dice Clay monologue. Oh!
Oh! Ma!
Oh! We're about to go, ma! Oh! It feels like it. And to the point where you can basically call him mini Tony Danza in this movie. You really can.
You know what's funny? You mentioned Tony Danza. I don't think we will ever cover a Tony Danza movie unless it's by accident.
And the only one we will cover is actually one you're probably not going to be on. It's going to be me and DJ Sue.
Don John.
Me and DJ Sue are definitely going to do Don John. Not because, you know, Joseph Gordon-Levitt bangs Scarlett Johansson. Not because Tony Danza is a freaking treasure in that movie. But for one reason. Joseph Gordon-Levitt jerked off so many times in the movie that we have to talk about it.
Yeah, and then all of a sudden he hooked up with what's-her-face at the end of the movie.
Julianne Lewis, yeah. Julianne Moore. Yeah, he ended up with her because and this is DJ Sue's words, not my own. CD, what you got to realize, it ain't the way she looked. It wasn't her age. It's the fact that she knew how to throw that pussy around. I'm like, I got it.
It's like, hey, honey, you don't need that hand anymore.
Let me guess, you got a 10, did you? Yeah, and she don't know how to ride dick. No, she don't. Well, boo-boo, lay back. You about to get something in the head, boy. Look, what you going to do? Oh, my God.
Daniel. He's at a beach party before school. This is like the still the summer and stuff.
And I love how they when they got out there. This is what I did say. One, there's a bunch of bullshit in this movie. I'll tell you the number one bullshit in this movie. Ain't no way in the world you drove that rickety ass car from Jersey all the way to California.
Sir, it's 84. That car can survive a fucking bombing and still work.
Oh shit! It did, dude. I don't want to hear that, man. That thing would have got to Utah and burnt out, man. Ain't no way you
put this way. Put this way.
3,000 miles across the nation, put man. No,
I would not trust it if it was driving down south, especially if it's driving through Arizona. So clearly, they drove in city areas in order to keep that car running. That's all I'm saying.
I like how they did. They did do the thing that. You ain't had no bad car until you did the shit they did where Daniel had to push the car and then she had to start the car up.
Man.
You ain't been bad car until you did some shit like that, son.
Hey, his mom was legit Jersey. Holy shit, was she Jersey as hell, man.
I don't think she looked. Look, he's like, she was legit Jersey. More Jersey than Ralph Macchio? I can't tell.
Yeah, that's true.
Ralph Macchio in that movie sounded like he already had two kids. he worked for the power company out in New York City. That's how he sounded like, man.
So Daniel meets Allie at the beach and stuff. Allie played by Elizabeth Shue, who's still acting.
which I hate to be that person, is the most successful person in this whole movie. Yeah, Elizabeth Shue beat everybody else out.
Not Pat Morita, but you know, that's just me.
The only reason why you can't say she didn't beat out Pat Morita only for one main reason, because Pat Morita went to legendary status because of this movie, because white people believe that Pat Morita really did no kung fu.
And also, let's be real, you are right, because Elizabeth Shue, once she got on fucking CSI, it was a wrap. She got her money up on that.
Nah. Elizabeth Shue was still getting a check every month because she was in Back to the Future 2.
Two and three, yeah.
Look, Liz, I got a question. You get any money for Back to the Future 3? Yeah, and I was asleep half that damn movie.
They actually let me chill and sit on the fucking bench. It was crazy. It was awesome.
This. I only did two scenes. That's wild as shit.
But shockingly enough, I do get a lot of money for The Saint. I love that Val Kilmer.
How about that Val Kilmer? You know what? Here's the best part about that. He's like, dang, for real. Yeah, but I still didn't get paid as much as Flea. Like, for real? Yeah, the 80s fucking suck for a woman.
Surprisingly enough, I got a lot of money from Cocktail. Interesting.
Excuse me, really? Really? Like, yeah. I look like, yeah, I'm surprised people know that movie.
Thank you, Tom.
Because nobody, it's kind of funny. Cocktail, nobody talks about that movie, man. That's a Tom Cruise movie.
What, Tom Cruise and not Michael Caine in that movie? Yeah.
Nobody talks about that movie, man. That's like one of the low tier Tom Cruise movies, which is ironic because he's still making low tier shit. You saw The Mummy.
Look, I still think to this day Tom Cruise is sitting back like, no regrets on The Mummy. Hey, when are we doing another Mission Impossible? I gotta make back that money again. All right, cool.
No, knowing Tom Cruise, he's probably laughing at you. See, that was my plan in the first place. Like, okay, Tom. And he starts jumping up and down, doing crazy shit. Then wants you to read this Dianetics book, and it gets real odd after that. But
Daniel meets Ali at the beach and stuff, and he comes upon his rival, Johnny. And Johnny, in typical douche fashion, he shows Daniel the ways of the Reseda residence and welcomes him with a fucking kick to the chest.
Now, it could be because I saw something on the internet and DJ Sue pointing me toward it, where they said that Daniel is actually the villain of the movie. Now, here's the funny thing about that. Daniel doesn't become a villain of the movie until about midway. Okay.
Oh, Wonder Holes into the fucking stall, that shit?
Oh, no, it's a little bit before that. They straight up kick him in the chest. Now, the reason why is because, like all stereotypical villains of the 1980s, they're him and his crew are having fun. Hey, man, is that your ex-girlfriend? Told you, man, it's over. But look at it. Look down at it. And Daniel's on the beach, you know, all not even bunned up. They were just talking to each other, having a fun time. He's like, hey, man, let it go. Nah, I'm not going to let it go. He goes...
I bet you said it that way, like, I'm not going to let it go. No.
No, because that's how they all sound. Everyone is always, amazingly enough, I think enough people have made fun of 80s movies to the point where we all know there's always a jealous boyfriend subplot.
Well, because there's always the logic goes out the window, because it's like, how is it that Johnny is like, well, it's over, but you're still trying to pull that control over, like, you know, you're not going to talk to any other guys. Just FYI.
Yeah, they do that in a lot of 80s movies where it's like, oh, I'm the new kid and I'm the villain of the movie and we need conflict. Huh, a girl. You're trying to take my girl.
I told you about that movie, The Wraith, with Charlie Sheen. It was set up the same way where the villain of that movie... He basically, it's like the chick wasn't his girl, but she was only his girl by default of the fact that he killed the boyfriend. So I'm like, so let me get this right. You killed the boyfriend and you just somehow just took her as your own. That's okay. All right, I guess.
I did the same thing in Rad where I think the same thing happened in Rad where it was like, like, hey, you're a pretty cool girl. Yeah, I gotta go. Why? I gotta go with my boyfriend. Hey, who's the loser? Now, because it's always
that. Now, did you love the fact that when Daniel rolled into Cobra Kai and stuff, he was all like, all right, Cobra Kai, it's going to be awesome. And he turns around and sees Johnny.
You guys see the wink that he gave him.
Oh, my God, son. That was like, yeah, I see you, nigga. You trying to be up in here? Now, here's the sick part. At that point, they could have been friends. They could have been friends.
But Johnny got slick with it, like, oh, you really thought you were going to come in here and learn karate and kick my ass? Okay, word. Word.
That's really what it was. That's really what it was, man. And it, you know what? You know what? There should have been a problem off the break, because before that scene happened, Daniel was going to school, right? And his mom like, let me see. Like, take off glasses. And I love his response. He's like, hey, your mom, this is California. It's always sunny. Come on, no, take your glasses. No, nah, mom's okay. Like, take off glasses. He just had this look like, all right. He took off his glasses. Oh, my God, who hurt my back? Like, Ma, was that Ma? No, I'm sorry. I'm doing it wrong. Oh, Ma, oh.
Little Miss Muffet sat on a tuffet. Oh.
He goes, hey, bitch, what's in the Yo, but yeah. He really thought he was going there and God had a friend. He's like, nah, dog, you ain't going to come up here doing Like I said, at that point, they could have been friends. They could have been like, yeah, I'm just trying to learn how to fight. Daniel does what's going to be a running theme in this and the next four movies, actually, including Hilary Swank, run like a bitch.
The funniest moment to me is directly after that where Daniel's inside the Chinese restaurant and you see Johnny and them like, oh, that's where he's at. All right, bet. I know where to get his ass after this. Because it's so funny because you see him and his mom talking. It's a heartfelt moment. She's like, all right, I know we moved to California, blah, blah, blah. And then you see Johnny's friend like, look, he's in the restaurant, guy. Let's fuck him up after this. It's like, yo, really?
Going to teach his ass to sit around and enjoy an afternoon with his mom. These villains, at least the bullies in this one, bullies are always the easiest to write, man. Because they need a lot of motivation to piss them off.
I'm an asshole. I'm just going to fuck with this kid.
Oh my gosh, man. There you got his ass whooped at least, how many times? At least four times. This is like the second ass. This is the second ass whooping he took. Now, unbeknownst to all of, well, if this was the first time you ever watched the movie, what you didn't know, I mean, early in the movie, the faucet broke. In their new apartment. So he's like, okay, get the maintenance man. So he goes down to the maintenance man, and just so happened, that's Mr. Miyagi. And Mr. Miyagi is like straight up on normal, grumpy Asian man level at this point. Because like,
he's an unassuming like, Asian.
I know, he's like this, like, we got a broken faucet upstairs. Could you go fix it? I go fix it. Like, you gonna do it now? Do it when ready.
Oh yeah, don't rush me, sir.
The way he said it was basically, let me translate that for you. Look, if you don't take your white ass upstairs, I told you I'm gonna fix it, alright?
Like I said what I said.
White people gonna tell me they're gonna you just moved in here. Cracker gonna tell me what the fuck to do. You know that's what Pat wanted to say, man.
Exactly. It's like, come on, man. It's like, you knew what the hell was happening. Actually, Daniel gets kicked off the soccer team because of just his anger issues and stuff and everything that's happening and stuff.
And when you notice that the bullies are a part of the soccer team, too. It's like,
you can't win for shit.
Not win for nothing. And kudos to the girl that he likes, because she's just straight up like, what's wrong, Daniel? I don't want to talk about it. Like he'd be like, wait a minute, just don't, like, I know his friends, they're nothing but a bunch of jerks. Oh, could you get off my back? Oh. So I know that O is hurting you. I know that's hurting you.
No, nah, I was just like, hey, this bitch won't get off my back. Oh.
Oh. So at this point, because I like what he told his mom, like, how did the karate on class go? It was too expensive anyway, mom.
Like, really?
Nah, it wasn't. You saw your boy give you a wink at that show, and he was like, nah, I ain't trying to have that. I don't want those problems, man.
I ain't nobody's bitch.
I ain't want those problems, man. So, just so happens, Daniel's at home, pissed off at life, are doing these really? And I got to be honest with you, because I
saw direct to VHS karate instructional videos.
Yeah, because I got to be really honest with you, his stance and his posture doesn't get better even after Mr. Miyagi's help. So whatever, but whatever. He's up there. Mr. Miyagi's fixing the sink, right? He's like this. Oh, that karate. I'm sorry, Mr. Miyagi. Kind of. All right, look, here, check it out, Pat Morita. I know you meant well, but you do realize you going full on Japanese kind of held your race back a little bit in this country. You do realize that, right? You do? Okay, I just want to make sure.
just so you know, FYI.
But he's like, so you know karate? He's like, oh no, I'm trying.
I'm trying. You know, it's there. You know, it exists.
Not like it's like not one of them limp wristed punches you doing, nigga.
Listen, man, I'm sitting there looking at this whole thing like, dog. Okay, you went to instructional videos.
I like the side kick he was trying to do. It was just like this. It was like this half-assed front kick he was trying to do that had like no level to. Like, yeah.
Look, it's equivalent to me watching Power Rangers at 9 years old and trying to emulate the kicks.
Yeah, at least I jump kick like motherfucking Zach. I don't know about you.
Now, here's the thing. Now, we forget, too. So, Daniel's first run-in with the gang in terms of his first fight. Apparently, Johnny and them got dirt bikes because they're fucking rich.
Yeah. Apparently, in that section of California, you got dirt poor and rich living right beside each other. Which, I got to be honest with you, sounds like California. So, so never mind that.
So, they run him off the road, and he somehow goes down the hill. Which, it was weird to me about the scene. He's going down the hill, and somehow he just flips off the bike. I'm like, it looked like he was perfectly going down that hill pretty good. What the fuck happened? Throws his bike into the trash, and he's just like, I fucking hate California.
I love how you do it. This stupid bike. I hate you so much.
Oh. The look, fuck you want, ball. Mom?
Little ball come in there. Daniel, what's wrong? Like, oh, Ma, get off my back, bitch. Oh, like, Daniel.
Don't call me a Pat bitch.
Pat Morita, meanwhile, I love my Pat Morita. Yeah, Mr. Miyagi, meanwhile, is listening to all this shit like, white boy get ass kicked again.
Yeah, because unknowingly, while they're talking, they're in front of Mr. Miyagi's humble abode.
Which is nothing but two double doors. And I like how Mr. Miyagi turned his whole apartment into basically a two-bedroom Japanese apartment because he's Asian.
He's efficient. Efficiency, sir. Efficiency.
Efficiency, D. It's efficiency.
He made that bedroom efficient, all right? That's how it rolls. We see that when we get into part two about his humble abode because, holy shit, that motherfucking Okinawa got a goddamn mansion.
You know what? Yeah, we'll get into that in the second one. Yo, that didn't make any sense in the second one. But yeah, Mr. Miyagi is actually listening to all that all that go down. And the next day, Daniel Wong goes out and his bike is fixed. Mr. Miyagi fixed it because.
Hooray. I like you enough, Daniel.
That's pretty much what it is. Like, I see you have trouble doing punches. I want help. Like, can you just say help me or some shit, man? Because I got to be honest with you. You fixed my bike. All I'm expecting next is like some ice cream and you telling me to go to your house without a shirt on and stuff. So, you know, I just want to make sure this ain't no creep shit, right?
Now, here's the thing.
How did shit start, bruh?
Yeah, so now after the Halloween situation where Daniel gets back at Johnny, which I'm like, hey, Daniel, you know you're going to get your ass whipped for this, right?
Yeah, real quick, did y'all like how Mr. Miyagi set him up? Dude, he set him up and said, oh, so you won't go to the Halloween event if you don't have a costume, right? It's like, yeah, okay. He gives him a shower costume.
Basically wearing a San Diego Chargers jersey. He basically has a shower curtain as a cost. I'm like, yo, what the hell is this, man?
So
like Miyagi, like, well, you know what Miyagi did? He's like, this white boy gonna look stupid as shit when he get that score.
Hey, I mean, so It's like Johnny and them are dressed up as the Day of the Dead skeletons or whatever and shit.
They're dressed up as skeletons and all that. And I like how Johnny was in the stall rolling up a J, which here's my thing I got to say about that. You a dick for what you did next, Daniel. That weed did nothing to nobody.
In an alternate universe where D is in the stall and Daniel does that, D will probably kill Daniel and that will be in the movie.
All right, some of you really need to understand. I know I say I love weed. I ain't killing nobody over that. I'm gonna be mad for 2 seconds. I'm gonna let that shit dry out.
that movie would end because Daniel was gonna be literally sitting outside of school expecting to ass whooping, and it doesn't happen.
I wouldn't have bet any amount of money. That shit was skunk weed anyway.
Ooh.
Man, look, look, he got a point there because there's a joke that's on the internet. Like, to get a gram of loud, if you're a black person, it costs $10. If you're a white person, $50. That's the
price. Black privilege, ladies and gentlemen. Black privilege.
Black privilege is best, man. So yeah, to all those white people listen to us, dude, you mean telling me Tyrone by the tracks is overselling me my weed? Yeah, white boy, here's some bad news. Even if you think even if you pay the $10, he ain't gonna give you a whole J, nigga. Anyway,
you realize, D, you just encouraged him to go into blackface right now, right?
I got shit to do with that. What you want me? Of the ass whooping that they're going to get? No, I don't care. No, I like how Daniel, first off, he heard the gang come in there. So Daniel takes the shower curtain and covers himself with it, right? I was like, good move, Daniel, son. So he's like, yeah, give me a minute, man. So they leave out. Daniel, for some reason, in this school, because the way it's set up, there's a hose connected to the sink. He just I don't know how he didn't see somebody putting the hose inside the stall, but he does. Turns that shit on. Daniel doesn't run fast enough. Also, let me make that very clear. Daniel does not run fast enough. He turns it on, jets off. He's like, "Hey, get him!" And the whole gang is trying to find this nigga. So they finally catch up with him, right? Jack him up against a fence. Here comes Mr. Miyagi.
Or Mr. Miyagi's stunt double who jumped over the fence.
How about this? Yeah, hey, that's the...
Hey, real talk though, who had the more egregious stunt double? Mr. Miyagi or fucking Victor Wong in fucking Three Ninjas?
Victor Wong. Victor Wong by miles.
Oh, look, here's the thing about Pat Morita's stunt double. Pat Morita's stunt double basically all he had to do was simple blocks and jumping over something. Victor Wong's did full-on backflips.
Look.
Thank you, dude. Thank you, because I was just about to point that out. I was going to say, first of all, when your stunt double does 7 backflips in a row, can't trust it.
Not at all. I'm with him on it. You can't, bro.
But hey, I believe for a second Pat Morita did that fucking leap kick. I believed it.
No, he did it. Because if he did that leap kick, then Victor Wong did that kip up.
I got to believe they had one take where Victor Wong tried it, and it's just like, shit, we need a stunt double.
Hey, you know what Victor Wong like. All right, Victor, you ready? Ready. And action. God. He blew out his back again. So let's stop. Let's just stop. Get the stump double back in here. Hey, Jason, Jake. Get back.
Hey, Jake, quit eating that goddamn pizza. Get back on set.
Wait, he was like, wait a minute. Did he throw out his back again? Yes, he did. God damn it. I'm getting paid scale, am I? Yeah, you are. Let's not skip this at all. Mr. Miyagi beat up a bunch of teenagers. He beat up a bunch of teenagers.
Here's the thing. Mr. Miyagi throughout the whole series has beat up teenagers 1 and 2 and ex-Karate Kid. He beat up young adults that were like 21 in the third movie. Mr. Miyagi just likes fucking up young people. Just saying.
But you know, no, he doesn't. No, he doesn't, because Mr. Miyagi always says the same thing. I don't like violence.
So he's early Jackie Chan with I Don't Want Trouble.
No. That's not a stereotype. I think because he was in the war, he knows what real violence is, and what he's doing is not real. Real violence.
Yes, that is the other subplot of this movie. He was a former soldier, and what war was it?
World War II, of course.
Yeah, World War II, and We found out that Mr. Miyagi lost his wife and son due to complications at childbirth, and they were in an internment camp.
Yeah, and of course, and
he was drinking at the time, too, as this happening. So, and you know what? I'll be honest with you. That is a sad scene because he's drinking clearly because he's just, you know, like grieving over that death and stuff. And he's just drunk and he's explaining everything that happened. You're like, damn, that fucking sucks.
It's actually probably the most, you know, I hate to go, oh, that's the most powerful scene in a movie where it's not meant to have these powerful scenes like that. But you know what? It grows. It is character growth. It is shows, yeah. You know, it shows like what that, what drives that person, all that. Now, no, this ain't a situation where, oh, Daniel's son is like my son or some shit. Oh, no. It's not like that. No. But
he takes a liking to him, like, though.
Yeah, he's taking a liking to him. But anyway, actually, it's after that, after Mr. Miyagi placing them hands on them children, because that's what, don't try to sugarcoat it.
Yeah, and them kids, they ain't even 16 yet.
I know, right? So he's like, so Mr. Miyagi basically tells on Daniel, son, if you want to fight like me, hey, come on over. I'm gonna teach you how to I'll teach you karate.
Hold up. No, before that, realize this. He does initially say he's gonna teach him. What he ends up telling Daniel is, well, I'm not gonna teach you, but I will walk with you to the dojo so we can get a kind of a ceasefire, like, hey, I don't want this shit anymore. And Mr. John Kreese, the Cobra Kai, you know, teacher, is just scoffing at the idea of, really? You're a fucking pussy. How about you fight him instead?
Hey, yo, dude, can we talk about Cobra Kai as a place anyway? First off, I always like, you know what? This is not no knock on anybody who is not Asian that has their own dojo, okay? This is not no knock on nobody. But the way Cobra Kai was ran, I can imagine there's a bunch of Trump supporters that has a dojo like that with a white guy running it, trying to teach them Asian stuff, and yet at the same time teaching them to be racist as hell. That's what it came off like, man. It came off like, they're like, all right, kids. Like, all right, guys, you did a good job. Now remember, vote Reagan. That's what it sounded like to me, man.
Oh, I got the quote, and this is what makes, and this is why I like John Kreese, right? So there he's all like, you know, Dan's like, I don't want to fight. And you know, Mr. Miyagi's like, yes, no more fighting. And here's Kreese. This is a karate dojo, not a knitting class. You don't come into my dojo, drop a challenge and leave, old man. Now get your boy on the mat, or you and I will have a major problem.
Excuse me, what planet did you come off of, dude?
And then turns around, and then when Mr. Miyagi was like, all right, leave boy alone, so, and I'll train him. And then Kreese is like, you're a pushy little bastard, ain't you? But I like that. I like that. All right. No one touches the prima donna until the tournament. Is that understood?
No, you gotta be that one kid in the back. Master, I got a question. What is it? I just came here just to learn. I'm not here to jump nobody.
And what you don't see, the deleted scene, everybody spreads out to the side, and that one kid's left in the middle, and he just kicks him in the face and kicks him.
Oh, you know that happened. Oh, you know that happened. He screams. He's like that. He's like that one football coach that you know is body slamming all his players. He's like that. He's that one coach that punches, does full contact to his students. Why? Because they can't learn no other way.
He was like, my mom just paid you $100 for these lessons. What are you doing, coach? Why are you kicking me? I didn't come here for that.
Yo, man, it's so funny, man. It's so funny when it comes to that. He runs it like they're in Marines, which ironically. No, yeah, that. And which ironically, in the fourth one, it's like all the ROTC kind of is the villains of it, and it makes you think, huh? Almost like Cobra Kai when you think about it.
But Cobra Kai, but not Cobra Kai.
Like I said, when it comes to Cobra Kai itself, it's like, yo, outside of these karate tournaments they win, why would you tell your kids to go to this place? It's like they just really scan all their kids. They discriminate all their students, man. Like, you can only be a certain person to get in that school.
I gotta be real about this, man. Yeah, I find it was awesome the fact that Lamar from fucking Revenge was part of Cobra Kai. I was like, holy shit, he didn't even fight. He was just there like, hey, dog, I just came here to karate because I live in the ghetto and I need to show these motherfuckers I mean business, so y'all can have this shit.
You know what? It's kind of funny. I do like how the bullies, the other bullies, are part of just all of a sudden, as the movie went on, they got more and more, hey, man, let him go, as the movie went along.
Didn't you trip him up at the beginning of the movie and antagonize him? Now, all of a sudden, you got a heart of gold now? Like, get the fuck out of here,
all
man.
All of a sudden, I like how they just slowly just turn, like, you know what? This is bullshit what we're doing to Daniel, man. We gotta stop. We gotta
even
stop.
Even Johnny, I'm looking at Johnny like, no, dude, you started this shit. Now, all of a sudden, you got, get the fuck out of here, man.
I'm saying, you the one that started. Yeah, but so anyway, Miyagi is a person you don't want to trifle with because he says, all right, I'm going to train the kid myself. We're going to whoop your ass. Like, and what? He points at the tournament, though. The tournament. So let me get this very, very...
The All-Valley Karate Tournament, sir.
So let me get this very, very, very correct. You're going to enter a student... I enter a child into the tournament. This child who has not gotten one lesson from you yet. Not only are you going to train him how to do karate, but you're going to train him enough time to kick everybody to beat Cobra Kai at the end. I got a question. What if Daniel fucks up in the first round and he's out? You look like an idiot. So I don't like no, that. Was just like that right there.
No, but with me, John Kreese was like, I like the cut of your jib, old man. You're confident in him. All right, I'll humor you.
That's what I'm like. You know what? Here's the sad part. I don't blame him because I'm like, he ain't going to make it out the second round. I got you, man. Bet. Because that dude ain't going to make it. And that's what the best part about it. And the best part about it was that it then turned into a pure 80s movie at that point. Because, hey, D, it's a tournament, and you always win the tournament.
So, you want to tell them about the Daniel's training regiment?
Bullshit. All of it is bullshit. None of it teaches you how to do anything. The famous one that we all know is about wax on, wax off. Mm-hmm. You do it with your left hand. You wax with your left hand, wax it off with the right, or is it the other way around? I don't know. But it's wax on, wax off. And Daniel's out there like, okay, and you gonna teach me how to do the karate? Yes. Wax on first, wax off now. Like, okay,
you
but
do
we're gonna
all
learn
these cars.
And yeah, I gotta give it up to Miyagi. You got these pristine 1950s, 60s hey, cars.
Somebody saved his coins up in the military.
The same, man. That's like, just imagine that. Let's take it into terms now. Imagine if your best friend went into the military and saved up all his money, and by the time we all hit 50, he has a fleet of motherfucking Dodge Chargers. That's kind of how that is.
Now, after Miyagi teaches him wax on and wax off, he teaches him paint up and down.
Because that teaches... painting!
and then paint side to side. Then, fucking...
I like how he told him to flip it over, though. He told him to flip it. He told him, like, no, do both sides. Like, up, down, left, right, and all the rest of that. And Daniel only did half the all, did one fist. He's like, oh, good, do all.
then... when he gets to doing the full floor wax on, wax off, that's when Daniel was like, yo, fuck you, old man. What the hell, man?
Hold up. You did it wrong. That's when Daniel go, oh!
This is bullshit, sir. Bullshit. Oh!
Hey, yo, Mr. Chopsticks. Oh!
Bruh, you say Mr. Chopsticks?
Yo, I got to think of something that's racist, but it's not a slur. So that was the best thing I came up with.
So apparently, the muscle memory of him doing these menial tasks allows him to defend himself in blocking punches and kicks.
I want to tell you something, Chris. I want to tell you something real. This comes from my heart. This is an exclusive on Three Black Geeks because I have never said this before. This movie is full of shit.
Come on now, sir. I'm jumping ahead of this, but the crane is full of shit, all right?
Son, you know... Okay, when we get to that part, I'll tell you what it is. But yeah, dude, you mean to tell me that all this was teaching you how to block? Daniel barely knows how to punch. Like, so you going to tell me that wax on, wax off, because... And here's the bullshit. He's like, no, block. Wax on, wax off. Yeah! I'm like, yeah.
So
he did yap that. He scared the shit out of Daniel.
So over time and stuff, you know, Daniel is learning martial arts and stuff, and him and Miyagi, they're connecting and such. To the point that Daniel, you know, he's on his way to a dance, and Miyagi was like, hey, I'll let you borrow one of my cars to go to the dance.
You like really? Really, I can?
Yeah.
Now, hold on. No. It was actually Daniel's birthday.
Ah, yes.
Yeah, it was Daniel's birthday, which it was so funny. He was like, Miyagi come out there with a bigger birthday cake and all that. I was like thinking to myself, like, hey, Daniel, where your mom at, man? Where your mom at? And then halfway through, oh, I just realized my mom. She's supposed to meet me. He's like, oh, okay. You take God. Like, wait a minute, what?
Do you have your license, Daniel?
Daniel, lie like shit. Yeah, I do.
And Mr. Miyagi's looking at him like, I don't want to believe you, but okay. Yeah. But you know, you say Daniel can't throw a punch.
You know what Miyagi said, right? Miyagi was pretty much saying like that, like, he probably don't have license. But then again, those tags are expired, and I just say somebody stole it.
Hey, my name is Mr. Miyagi. Is that your first name, sir? Yes, Mr.
Mr. Yo, please tell me he has. Please tell me they say his name eventually. I never knew his first name. Does he have a first name?
No. They just said Miyagi. Now, actually, his first name is Kisuke Miyagi.
All right, Kisuke Miyagi. Okay, yeah, I'm about to say. Yeah,
they say his full name when he gets to. The second one where his old rival just says his full name to really emphasize that he's his rival. Like, Kisuke.
The one thing we didn't mention was the bonsai tree. Him cutting up the bonsai tree. We did not mention that.
So Mr. Miyagi throughout this whole series, the bonsai tree is important to him. And, you know... Apparently, you know, he is clipping it. Now, I'm not too familiar with bonsai trees other than I know that they are a very important part of Asian culture to a point.
Yeah, I think that, I can't. This will be an interesting thing. We could bring this up later on in like the other two because bonsai trees are kind of a theme in this fucking on franchise anyway. But there is something about relaxing and Zen type. Meditation. I don't know the whole aspect of it. If I was a smart person, I would have looked it up before that, but don't worry. The bonsai tree is going to come up again, especially in the second one, if I'm mistaken, too.
But
I like how Daniel X was like, yeah, so, you know, no, I'm sorry, I did it wrong. Oh, who taught you how to cut this?
It's beautiful. Beautiful, just like that woman I fucked last night. Oh.
Hey, did your dad teach you how to cut this? Yes, dad taught me how to cut. Oh, that's a good thing.
Now you said Daniel didn't know how to punch. Now, Miyagi did teach him how to punch and stuff, and he had on like the little baseball gear, and Daniel's punching him in the chest and stuff.
I love that. I was like, yo, because you know if Daniel punches too high, he's going to hit that face mask and break his hand. You know that, right?
Because Miyagi's face is like steel.
Nah, Miyagi ain't shit. Miyagi ain't shit. That's why. Miyagi punch too high. See what happened.
So Miyagi gifts Daniel the gi, and it has the bonsai tree in the back.
Yeah.
Which is representative of the school.
Yeah, and also, he's like, I promise to give it back. He's like, no, it's okay. And when he said it, here's me. He got like five more.
Crazy part is, I found it ironic Daniel wears that same dingy ass fucking gi in the fucking third movie.
Yes, he does.
Yeah. It's like, this shit still fits.
Oh my god, yeah. You know what? Of all the training scene, of course, because it's the '80s. What do you think we hear? Do 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 do. Gotta be better than the man.
Gotta believe when the going gets tough, and the man's gonna learn to take it. History repeats itself. Try and you succeed. I can't believe I know the fucking lyrics.
You're the best around.
For real, South Park did the best rendition of that fucking song with Stan, his dad, like kicking the shit out of everybody at every baseball game.
Oh my god, that's one of my favorite ones, because I died laughing when Randy took off his shirt. What are you gonna do?
What? It's America, man. Can't fight in the fucking baseball.
No, it's America. I'm sorry. Also, that's one of my favorite episodes for one main reason. A lot of people don't know that they're looking at Kenny dead in the face and looking at Kenny the whole time. Nobody knows it's Kenny because Kenny doesn't say nothing. But if you know South Park well enough to know how his real face looked like, you'd be like, hey, that's Kenny.
Yeah. Particularly when you get to the part where he's playing the superhero and shit. It's like, oh, that's Kenny. Yeah.
Yeah, when he plays the, I forgot the name of that dumbass thing, whatever the thing is. Yeah. But yeah, you know that's Kenny. So whatever.
Now, Trouble in Paradise here. Side here. Trouble in Paradise, him and Allie get in an argument because Allie doesn't want him to fight. Because she feels in her eyes he's become the bully that she didn't want him to be.
Hey, Allie, you're right. Because if you really look at what Daniel does in his movie, he's a bit of a dick.
Hey, Allie, I came here to talk. Oh!
Hey, don't you like the car I just got for this old Asian man? Boom! Maybe we can pull up to the side, I finger you. Hey, oh!
Chopsticks over here taught me how to do wax on and wax off. Oh!
You're just going to stick with the chopstick name, ain't you?
I blame you for this. I blame you on that.
Hey, chopsticks! Oh! Over here! Oh, man. The other name I would have went for was shrimp fried rice, but you know, whatever. that's more Chinese than anything else.
Now, through his power of persuasion, Ali eventually comes around when he sweet talks to her, like, hey, I can bring you over here to my place, and you know, we can do a little something. Oh,
all he did was go over his place and play on Pac-Man. They ain't do shit. They ain't do nothing. Yo, but I did like how she got in the car and he had to teach her how to get it out of first gear and all that. And I'm laughing like, oh, that's cute. She fucked that whole clutch up. I know she did.
Mr. Miyagi stares disapprovingly at that.
Boy, man. He's like, hey, Mr. Miyagi. Hey, Mr. Miyagi, can you look at this?
Stares at Miyagi.
Look, Miyagi in there. What happened to clutch? I don't know. I got this broad here. You let somebody else drive the car? Yeah? Oh, my God. Daniel, you're not even assured. Why did you make somebody else drive this car?
Hey, I was trying to get in the pennies. Oh!
Like, did you? Did you? And he drops the whole Andrew Dice Clay voice. No, sir, I didn't.
No, oh, my God.
The one time he just drops the whole accent, yeah? So, but yeah, the whole time when you really look at how Daniel does this shit, he comes off like a jerk, really, man. You know, of all, you know, if anything, it's more jerk-like behavior than anything else. So finally, the day comes. The day that we all been waiting for. The karate tournament. All right.
Oh, Cobra Kai dudes end up antagonizing the fuck out of Daniel in the locker room. I'm like, y'all guys got balls to just go up in there and just run up on him while he's getting dressed and shit.
Also, not only is Mr. Miyagi and Daniel look like bad guys, they're also dishonest as hell, too. Because when they get up there, they was like, hey, we don't have all... Like, wait a minute. He can't enter the tournament unless he's above a brown belt. Oh, he black belt. Lying ass. And not only that, they steal a black belt to give him. I'm like, yo, why you take that dude's black belt, man? He probably need... So then, like you said, now... Then you like you said, they go up in the he like Daniel's changing up in the locker room. Here come Cobra Kai. I'm like, y'all are some jackals. And I like how one of them was like, hey, man, we can't do it here, man.
Whoa, the ref busted up in there in the red shirt and was like, hey, gentlemen, keep it out in the ring. What are we doing here?
So they go in there. Like, so when he goes in there, Miyagi and Allie lie because they say he's like, wait a minute. She's his translator. He speaks Japanese. Oh, konnichiwa. I'm like, yo.
And the dude bows like, oh, well, I guess he must be Japanese. All right, bow. All right, cool.
I do love how he said, oh, he said that he has an uncle that looks like you. Oh, well, thank you. and he just had this smile. And was like, huh, I just met a charming Asian man.
No, you're saying it wrong, D. Huh, I met a charming Chinaman.
No, you did it wrong. No, you did it wrong. Huh. You know what? Those Orientals are all right.
He looks like a dude that says Oriental. Real talk. He looks like a guy that says Oriental and doesn't know the fact that it's fucking offensive as hell, and he'll defend it until another Asian person tells him it's offensive.
Yeah, that's on the same level, because you know what the Southern United States equivalent of that is? A white person saying, look, I love the colors. What do you mean I can't use the term colored?
Well, I love the blacks. Oh, Jesus Christ, man. You can't say that.
Can't say that either, dude. You can't say that. Like, oh, God, all of these Negroids. Like, look, all you Negroids, you call me a Negroid? What?
Oh, Jesus Christ. Now,
Todd, stop talking. There's one thing we got to mention before we go into this, turn of this movie. You mentioned earlier the crane kick. Now, remember the famous poster that we get of him on the beach doing the crane pose,
on the rocks.
Right? On the rocks and all that, right? All right. Do you realize that that move is complete BS?
Oh, dude.
Never in the history of man has anyone lost to a crane kick.
You know who told me that off the break that it was bullshit? My dad. Me and my dad were watching The Karate Kid on cable, right? I'm a kid, by the way. And he looked at me like, now, Chris, you know that's bullshit, right? And as a kid, I'm laughing like, no way, Dad. You can win with the crane. It's like, no, you don't understand. That's bullshit.
Very interesting who told me that was a BS move. Our friend who is a stuntman now, Gary Peebles, he was the first person to tell me that that move was BS. Back in the 8th grade, he told me that move was BS. And now what he's like, oh yeah, so what's he doing today? That nigga been in a bunch of movies. Sit down. He know what he was talking about.
Kung Fu expert too, so I'm just saying.
Kung Fu expert, dude's pretty good at weapons. Gotta be honest with you, his head don't match his body, but
he knows that. And low-key, he's told everybody when he wears jeans, he looks like a woman from behind, so, you know.
Look, he said that. Look, I didn't say that. I wasn't even gonna say that, man. See, I was gonna make fun of his titties, but I gotta be honest with you, I wish I had his physique, so... Jealousy.
Now, listen, I'm laughing here because when you look at the montage of the tournament, there's some strong contenders in this tournament. I'm just sitting there like, yo, how did Daniel beat this dude? I don't get this.
Dude, one black kid that was in it, I was like, that nigga, how did he get knocked out? What happened to him? Who took him out?
Yo, Daniel took out Lamar from fucking Revenge of the Nerds with a punch to the chest. I'm like, huh?
That one dude that got hit in the head with a high kick, and that was it. I was like, yo, for real? How y'all, like, how do these points go? How do these points go in this thing? So, because it's an 80s movie, we get to the finals. It is Daniel versus...
No, semifinals. You didn't mention famous scene here. Sweep the leg, sir.
Yeah, I forgot. We get to the semifinals. Now... Just so happened, Cobra Kai is in a win-win situation. Not only wait. So one of our boys is going to the finals, and the other one that's in the semifinals is going against Daniel's son. All right, we won this one. Hey, yo, master, sweep the leg. Wait, hold on. I'm trying to win the sweep, but but I don't want to sweep it. What do you want you to talk about? Sweep the leg. I don't want to do it, coach. Sweep the leg. Guard.
Guard.
Like, sweep the leg, big fella. But I don't want to do it. Sweep the leg, big fella. Guard.
I didn't come here. I didn't come here for this.
Like, you ain't coming for this. Now get in there and get knocked out the tournament. But I want to win in front of my grandma. You can't win, big fella. Go for sweep the leg, big fella. Who made you like this?
Subline here. I think John Kreese placed a bet on his boy Johnny to win.
Son, that was the next thing I was going to go to, man. John Kreese knew that he had this tournament in the bag, so much so that he said, "Hey, yo, Johnny, I got some money on you, bro. Don't even worry about it. We the only karate school in the whole area that's worth a damn anyway." So
cut to 3 years later, Karate Kid 3, and John Kreese is out the job.
You know what? Here's the thing about it. It's like, wait. He knew somebody that was going to make a bet on a karate tournament? Yeah. He's one of those guys that know a bookie that places bets on anything. So come on, man. You got the trick is you got to dig deep enough to find the people like that. You know, that's a real trick about it. You can't give up. So what happens when Daniel goes into the match? They sweep the fucking leg. Daniel goes on the ground. He's hurt as hell, man. Of course, he gets kicked out. So Daniel's out, and the only one in there is Johnny. Son, Cobra Kai strategically made sure that they would have won the championship no matter what. Now, because it happened earlier in the movie, and I didn't mention it, but again, Asian magic saves the day.
What are you doing there, Mr. Miyagi? Oh!
Hey, what you going to do there with those two hands? You're rubbing your hands like your Birdman over there. Oh! He slaps his hands together, rubs them really, really hard.
Massages and shit out of the fucking leg.
Now here's my thing. When they did it the first time, you heard this, what I like to call the pan flute Asian magic music. And all of a sudden, he rubs his hand together. He's like, okay, so the winner, wait, what? Oh, the Miyagi school, the Miyagi Dojo's coming back again. They're like, whoa.
As Daniel limps into the fucking ring, and I'm like, okay.
Because he's fucking Willis Reed and shit. So it's like, okay, so they're gonna fight. And so Johnny's like, ah, crap, all right, let me kick this dude's ass, and before he can go out there, Master grabs him. Like, we say sweep the leg, no mercy.
So Daniel during the fight, he punches Johnny in the face and he's bleeding, and here comes John Kreese. Oh, you're bleeding. All right, I see that kid means business. Again, as you said, sweep the leg.
This is like, yo, man. So it's even 1-1 in the count. What is Daniel going to do now? Daniel goes for the famous bullshit jutsu itself, the crane kick. And when he does it, the music kills me at that point. And here's the thing about this. Johnny, you ran into that.
Yeah.
You ran directly into that kick because all he did was take two steps, whack up right across the chin, match over. I'm like, BS.
Now, BS. Here's the funny part about it, right? I'm like, yo, Johnny, it's like Johnny just forgot his training and just said, you know what? I'm going to be like random henchman number 3 in a Jackie Chan movie. Charge!
Exactly. He got kicked in the face, and it was the way he got kicked in the face and rolled over to the side that made it so funny to me. And then, of course, everybody storms the ring, and Johnny passes him the trophy. I'm like, okay, F you, movie.
Johnny jobbed out like a putty patroller in a Power Ranger show.
You know what really happened? I got a subplot for you that we didn't know. Now, you mentioned that John Kreese put money on the fight. Well, guess what? Johnny knew about that.
Put money on Daniel.
Yeah, right before it started. Hey, yo, Mom, come here real quick. Hey, Mom, I got a question. Yeah, you got $400, right? Yeah. Put it on Daniel's son. But honey, just do it. We're gonna be millionaires. Let's do it, Mom. We get to go to Shoney's every night. Let's do this. Yo, he gets so everybody's throwing the ring. Elizabeth Shue goes there to kiss Daniel, and let's show Mr. Miyagi, who winks at the camera because you know Asian magic saved the day, and that is the Karate Kid part. And that is the Karate Kid part one. You know what? I'm glad that, you know what? It's kind of funny. I'm actually sad that it was just you and me on this one. You know, I actually am kind of sad, but don't worry because part two, three, and four, we're going to call on the whole squad. We're going to call, not only are we going to have DJ Sue be a part of that one, and probably going to be a big part of those two, but, we're gonna have Duke on for those other three too.
Oh, so that's gonna be deliciously good.
Ooh, that's gonna be special. Because here's the funny thing. In talking about what we really liked about this movie, on some real stuff, as much BS and this cornball cheesy as it is, I got to admit the acting is pretty damn good. Yeah. The act from Ralph Macchio is pretty good. It's something that you don't get a lot. You know, I don't know why. Like I say, it will fool you that he's like 20 something in this movie. But you know, when you look at it, he did it very well. He was all right. Pat Morita, as much of a stereotype as he is, how can you hate him in this movie?
You know what? He worked it though. I gotta give him that. He was like, "Fuck it. If I'm gonna do this, I might as well go full tilt into it."
You know what I mean? I gotta think the same thing for not Hattie McDaniel. The black man that was in the other black dude that was in Song of the South. Like, well, I am a Shakespearean trained actor, but boy, oh boy, I can play me a good old slave.
Zippity doo dah.
Zippity day, my oh my. Y'all getting mad at me for singing that song? Huh, some real shit. That Negro right there, he won an Academy Award. Respect that nigga name on some real shit. Don't get mad at that.
Now, hold up.
Hattie McDaniel was in that movie too. I don't see y'all throwing stones at her for that. This is gonna be real.
Now, here's the thing. They're making a Cobra Kai TV series. 30 years after the events of the first movie.
Why?
Johnny reopens Cobra Kai.
Why?
I don't know. I'm interested in this because Ralph Macchio's coming back as Daniel.
Wait, no, that even raises more questions. Wait a minute. What? So who's the bad guy?
I don't know. That's the crazy part. I don't know.
How would you like it if it got back to that and you find out that Daniel is the one running Cobra Kai?
No. That's what I'm saying. Johnny's running it. But like you said, what if it's like Ralph is all of a sudden we find out they flip the script and all of a sudden it's Daniel with the loose cannon and Cobra Kai got to stop him.
Cobra Kai has to clean up the streets. Of, wait a minute, we're part of all.
Reseda lost Reseda.
Nah, we got to pick a more bitch ass place in all California now.
Long Beach, California. Cobra Kai.
Not Long Beach. Yeah. Actually, don't fuck it. Yeah.
Or San Dimas.
San Medinas. No. We're the only school in Van Nuys that can stop them.
Daniel LaRusso is back. Oh, you miss me?
Oh, kids. Like, hey, kids, let's do these punches. Oh, one, oh, two, oh, three.
And I'm going to show you a special move. It's called the crane. Johnny's dumbass ran into it. Oh.
Son, if they put a crane kick in that movie, it's kind of funny. you know, like I said, we're going to be talking about the Karate Kid all throughout this thing, because just real talk, it's a real good movie. You know, there's not much to say about that outside of, you know, outside of having Jackie Chan and all that. They didn't have nothing stupid like the crane kicking it, did they?
Oh, because they basically had Jaden do something that actually made sense and stuff. It was a variation of it. I'm like, oh, okay, I'm fine with that. That's cool and stuff. But like I said, I think with that remake, though, them kids were fucking cutthroat like a motherfucker.
Also, I'm just going to be really real with you. That was kung fu. That wasn't karate.
Yeah. Jackie really emphasized, like, no, it's not karate. It's kung fu. So, you know, but hey, it's
right
it's,
then and there. Right then and there is like, so do we change that? No, it's still in the same universe.
Yeah, that's what
actually, that's the wild part. That would be the wild part. If Jaden Smith shows up in the show, that would be the wild part.
Yeah. I mean, so.
Show up with white dreadlocks. Like, who are you? I was out in China. And I learned this technique that you can teach Cobra Kai.
It's awesome, right? It's awesome.
Yo, why does Daniel's son own like the biggest dojo in California, but it's like ran like a corporation and all the kids wear suits?
Oh my God, man. He's running McDonald's dojos and shit.
You know what I mean? You know what I mean? Johnny, meanwhile, is just trying to get Cobra Kai back together. It's all dusted down and all that.
The only way you could really emphasize this Cobra Kai TV series, you got to bring back John Kreese. You got to.
Nah, John Kreese does not come back. If John Kreese comes back, it has to be this very, very powerful moment where Johnny goes to jail. It goes over to the jailhouse to meet him. Hey, Master. Hey, Johnny. How's it going? Open up Cobra Kai again. And all of a sudden, he puts the phone down like, you know you can't do that. You can't do it. Don't do what I did. Don't go down my path. And we said, look, I know you, Chris. I know you. Here's going to be you all over Twitter. Hey, John Kreese needs an Emmy for this. This is beautiful work that he's doing.
Got to be real about this, man. I'd be that one person on top of that. Be like, all right, if you really want to emphasize this, bring back Thomas Ian Griffin.
No. Thomas Ian Griffin.
I need Terry Silver back, dog. We'll get into it with part three, folks. I need Terry Silver, dog. I need douchebag Thomas Ian Griffin on top of fucking John Kreese.
Here's the funny thing. Now, I know of the movie, right? I have never seen the third movie.
Oh, you're going to love it. Oh, my God.
I am so ready for the third one because you have hyped it up so much to me. Ever since we started, actually, that's the interesting thing. Ever since we started Three Black Geeks, we flirted with doing the Karate Kid. And even when we didn't do it, we'll bring it up in conversation. And every now and then, Chris, you would say, D, why haven't you seen the third one? For whatever reason, I just never did. The only time I had a chance to see the third one, it came on and I caught it like 20 minutes in, and I was like, I'm going to watch the rest of this shit. And I think I either fell asleep or I had to leave the house, whatever happened. And I never got to see it again. So now that it's on our list, I cannot wait. I can really, really not wait for it, man.
He knows real quick, I'm a Thomas Ian Griffin mark a little bit because it's like, yeah, it's Thomas Ian Griffin.
Here's the funny thing. I know about Thomas Ian Griffin. Oh, yes, I know about him. I know. See, it's really funny. I think DJ Sue to an extent also. I think everybody, especially if you're in this line of work of podcasting, if you do action movies, to me, I don't respect you unless you know about the unsung heroes of the 90s when it comes to the action movie.
Daniel Bernhardt, Thomas E. Griffin, Don the Dragon Wilson.
Don the Dragon Wilson, Speakman.
Eric Roberts for a hot second.
Eric Roberts is an everyman, so he kind of doesn't count on that one.
Michael Dudikoff.
Who's the other guy?
Sasha Mitchell. Sasha Mitchell.
Yeah. The Costcos. You have to know these. You have to have knowledge of these people.
Oh, yeah, Billy Blanks too.
Billy Blanks will count. Yes, he would. Even the sub even the sub ones, even if you don't know their names, you know who they are when you see them. You know what I mean? Those type of people. So I think you're not, I think if you're doing like, yeah, I got a podcast, you do action movies. Yeah. If I say Jeff Speakman and you look at me weird, I should slap you. Yeah. I should just slap you because you have no respect. You have seriously no respect. Oh yeah. Bosworth counts on that one to me.
Yes, he does.
The boss counts for that one for me too, man. But yeah, you like it's funny that one of those sub, I don't even call him subpar, that's just me, but one of those B-rated action stars made it into a movie that actually went to theaters like that. And that's Thomas Ian Griffin, and that's why I'm actually excited to see the third one. Before we go though, how did you like this movie? What is your opinion on the first movie though?
Yeah, I actually did like the first movie and stuff. Like I said, it's part of that golden era of the 80s where it's just, we enjoyed those movies, you know, because like I said, that's the same year Back to the Future came out and stuff, 84. I mean, shit, that was the year I was born, so it holds a place in my heart and stuff, because that was just that golden era of just craziness and stuff, and just the plot and just the characters themselves, just everything was just larger than life, basically.
When you think about it, I think Rocky was the one that really got these type of movies off. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
These sports movies to where it's like the underdog and he makes it at the end. Now, it's kind of funny in this is just a primer for the second one. See, in the second movie, there really isn't a lot of conflict. It's just more of, you know, all of this would have been avoided if XYZ.
Yeah.
That's really what happens in the second one. And I think we're ready for that one. So next time you hear us, Franchise Muff continues on. We'll be doing the Karate Kid 2.
AKA Miyagi Takes Okinawa.
AKA on some real shit. This is where the series are going on a downward spiral. But don't much tell like, nobody.
Much like Signs, you can see the cracks happening.
You can see the cracks. And it's kind of funny to go back on the other franchises that we did. When we did The Matrix, The Matrix Reloaded off the brick told you, all right, y'all.
Hold on to your butts.
Let me tell you what you're not going to feel. You're not going to feel any of the magic in the first one. Like, we didn't get that until, like, when we did not Transformers. When we did The Terminator, we didn't feel that into the third Terminator, and we didn't feel that way until we saw the Matrix's boobs inflate. That's when we all said, "Yeah, this ain't the same series. This thing has let go on us."
Shockingly enough, though, just to end it though, 2 does provide a bit of a prologue. Basically kind of a closure to the ending of Karate Kid 1, because I like to say, it's rare that a movie ever puts on, I wonder what happened after Cobra Kai lost. And that's where we begin with 2. And it's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. There actually is some closure. They don't do that normally in movies, man. Just imagine if we got done with Back to the Future 2. And they did do that. Never mind.
Back to the Future 3, it's like, I wonder what's going to happen next after the train comes in and it's like, oh, shit, they did, okay, oh, fuck, all right.
All right, okay, they ran it over. All right, we're done with that one. That's the end of the DeLorean. That thing kind of blew up really easily. Yeah, it's an AMC car. Those cars aren't really that strong. It's like this. Somebody did tell me that when it comes to the DeLorean, it's like, really, are DeLoreans that cheap? Yes, they are. They're like extremely, like, you know, they're not that good. You know, without that movie, nobody would give a shit about a DeLorean.
They really don't care, you know.
It's really a low-grade car when you really think about it. It only can go about 90 miles per hour, man. It's not powerful at all.
Yeah. That is it.
Yeah, so we're done.
Yeah, so we're it. And, catch you guys later. Peace out.